This show has been brought to you by sacredapparel.net. The homie Twink and the crew over there are always coming up with the latest fashions, the tees, the hoodies, and the hats. Right now, they got a store-wide sale going on, everything 20% off. This would be a great time to pick up a hoodie. Everything 40% off, regular price $40, now they $25 a hoodie. And the dope thing that I like about Sacred Apparel, they got tees for the big homies. So go check them out, sacredapparel.net, a clothing store for the ladies and gentlemen that choose to live sacred. You dig?
You are listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast, the podcast that's strictly for producers.
Are you looking for those heavy trap bangers? Then you definitely need to holler at Rock House Music, specialized and known for those bending 808s. You may have heard his recent work on K-Drama's The 8 album. So if that's the sound you're going for, holler at my man Anthony over at Rock House Music. You can check out his beats on SoundCloud at www.soundcloud.com/IamRockHouse. Again, that's www.soundcloud.com/IamRockHouse. Rock House Music, home of the bending 808s. Yes, sir.
You're listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast, where we talk about nothing but producer stuff. You dig?
Are you a producer or artist that is lacking confidence in your music? Well, now you can get your music critiqued by an industry vet. The Amazing Beat Critique by Producer Vet, The Amazing SB. Get your one-on-one video consultation via Skype or FaceTime. Submit 3 beats or 3 songs, and he will provide feedback and any questions that you may have pertaining to your music or the industry. So contact The Amazing SB today at AmazingBeatCritique@gmail.com. Again, that's AmazingBeatCritique@gmail.com. Contact him and book your session today.
4, 3, 2, 1.
This should be played at high volume.
You ain't got the answers.
Yo, what's good?
Yo.
Hey, yo, what's poppin'? It's your boy Swift.
Young Joshua.
This is
Surface.
This your man, K-Drama.
This is the Amazing SB, and you're listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast.
And you're listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast.
And you're listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast.
You are now listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast.
And you're listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast with my man Marv.
With my homie Marv.
With my homie Marv. With my man Marv from OB.
I'm a Marv from Vohnbeatz, baby, yeah.
You're listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast, where we talk about nothing but producer stuff. You dig?
Yo. What up? What up? What's up out there in Producerville? Welcome to the ShowLab Producer Podcast, man. This is your boy Marv from Vohnbeatz. How y'all doing? Happy belated 4th of July. Hope you guys had a good time. Hope you ate enough barbecue and had a good time with your family, hung out, popped firecrackers and all that stuff, man. I had a real good 4th of July, man. It was really good, man. Me and my wife, we got up, took our kids out on the water. It's a spot called the Slab, where you literally go swimming in the water, in the lake out here. We went and did that, man. Chilled out there. Came home, barbecued. I did some barbecue myself. And then we was invited to a barbecue. One of the brothers and sisters from my church, man, they had this big old 4th of July blast by their crib, man. So we just hung out, man, outside playing basketball, kids playing volleyball, riding their bikes. I was riding my bike yesterday, man, and just had a good old time. I was tired when it was all over, but I had a good time, man. My kids enjoyed themselves, man. My wife, she wanted to do family thing. I was down for that, so we had a great time, man. So happy 4th of July for everyone. Hope it was safe for everybody. And yeah, mine was good. We have a good show for today. Today, I am honored and blessed to have the legendary S1 and his son Vohnbeatz on the show. They are a father-son, I don't want to say, I guess I could say production team, but they are father and son, and both of them produce, man. And today we're talking about the importance of, you know, parents paying attention to their kids' gifts, helping their kids to hone in on the gift. And, you know, I just think it's great how he made a platform for his son. And we're going to have them on the show in a little bit. It's going to be an interesting and great interview just to see it from a parent's perspective, you know what I'm saying? And just, you know, how important our jobs is to do that. We have a very important job to be able to nurture and raise our kids up, not only in the admonition of the Lord, according to the scripture, but, you know, being able to help them fulfill their destiny and their gifts and stuff. So it's going to be a great show, going to be a great interview. Before we get into this thing, I got to start with the scripture. You know, I always start a podcast. For those that are tuning in for the first time, I always open up with the scriptures. And I'm actually going to read a commentary pertaining to this scripture. Scripture is Proverbs chapter 17, verse 6, from the Benson Commentary. And it reads, "Children's children are the crown of old men." The commentary reads, It's an honor to parents when they are old to leave children and children's children growing up that tread in the step of their virtues and are likely to maintain and advance a reputation of their families and to serve their generation according to the will of God. And the second part of that verse is, "And the glory of the children are their fathers, namely fathers that are wise and godly. To have such parents is an honor to children, and to have them to continue to them even after they themselves are growing up and settled in the world. Those are unnatural children indeed who reckon their aged parents a burden to them," talking about, you know, those that be driven, "and they live and think they live too long, whereas if the children be wise and good, it is their greatest honor that hereby they are comforts to their parents in the unpleasant days of their old age." So basically it's saying, man, you know, the children's children is the crown of old men, meaning that their children are growing up and being able to excel and keep the generations going on, you know what I'm saying, with the wisdom and the godly character, you know what I'm saying. And also the commentary was saying, you know, how for a child that don't take heed to that, you know what I'm saying, it's a burden on the parents, but it's a beautiful thing when the children can take heed. The parents doing their part, doing their job, is nurturing and, you know, raising the children upright, you know, setting up, having a great foundation at home, you know what I'm saying, mother and father in the home, and, you know, giving them the biblical foundation and just teaching them the way of life, you know, structure. When we get old as older people and we see our kids go on, now we may be reckoning pain, and God forbid that happens, but it comforts us to be able to see our kids growing up, not in the streets. You know, when my mom and dad passed, I think that was the best thing I could have ever left them, from them seeing me being this dude that was in the streets and then coming to be this man that's living for the Lord. You know what I'm saying? You know, my mom, I grew up in a single parent home, so my mom knew that I was out up to no good, selling weed, selling a little crack here and there, you know what I'm saying, and being a whole mongler and all that stuff. But then she was able to see that change when I surrendered my life to God, changed and started to have a family. And even from the music, you know what I'm saying, she was able to know that her son, you know, was doing something to be able to using my gifts, because I've always was a drummer, so it was a blessing for her to see me to be able to use my gifts, you know what I'm saying, and, you know, going on in life and doing good. Even my dad, you know, my dad didn't raise me, but my dad, he always would be bragging on us as his kids, and he would always tell people that I didn't know, people in my family that I produced, my dad had already told him, like, man, my son is a producer, man. He making music, you know what I'm saying? And I'm so proud of him. So, you know, I'm glad, you know, that, you know, before they passed on, they was able to see that. And, you know, prayerfully, you know, me and my sisters can continue to keep a generation, keep that generation going. So, with all that being said, Proverbs 17, verse 6, go check it out. Dissect it, read it for yourself. It's a good scripture, you know what I'm saying, just to encourage parents. And, you know, just for the, just knowing that, you know, we have a job to do, man, to be able to keep the generation going. But anyway, like I said, we got a good show coming up. We're going to have S1 and Vohnbeatz on the show. Vohn going to talk about, we're going to talk about his first placement and, you know, how, you know, it would, how even with S1, he recognized that his son wanted to be a producer and the steps that he took to help him and all that stuff. So, man, we're going to get into that in a bit. This show has been brought to you by sacredapparel.net. Go check out the homie Twink. He got that fire. I'm waiting on my package in the mail, so I hope you're listening. I need my package in the mail, Twink, so send me my tees and whatever else you got in the goodie bag. Go check them out, sacredapparel.net. You're listening to the Show Lab Producer Podcast, where we talk about nothing but producer stuff. You dig?
You're listening to the Show Lab Producer Podcast, where we talk about nothing but producer stuff. You dig?
You're listening to the Show Lab Producer Podcast. I am your boy, Mar from Obeats. In producer news, on last week, on June 24th, 2016, at the age of 72 years old, we lost musician, producer, keyboardist, composer, child prodigy, George Bernard Worrell. For those that don't know, and that doesn't ring a bell, Bernie Worrell Jr. He was a keyboardist. He was one of the founding members for the group Parliament Funkadelics, and he also worked with the Talking Heads. He died last week of cancer. The reason I'm mentioning this gentleman, because he was the epitome of a person that knew the Moog, the mini Moog, inside out. Like, this dude, this guy, let me say this, the presets and the synths that we play on our keyboards or on our computer or whatever software you're using, if he would have patented those sounds, he would be making a lot of money off those sounds. So, like, because, like, a lot of the gangster leads and all of those, like the Lil Jon synths, when Lil Jon was biggest, when he was bigger in his time, those were synths that were created by Bernie Worrell. A couple of years ago, man, I was just intrigued about him. I did a research. Actually, I wrote an article about him on the website. It was just something how this dude was 8 years old writing full-fledged concertos. Like, he was a piano prodigy. I think he went to the Juilliard School of Music. I don't know the name of it, but it's up there in New York, I believe. He went to the best music schools, but he... Just to summarize up his story, He used to go hang out at the blues clubs where George Clinton and him were hanging out at. And then eventually he hooked up with Parliament, and he became a part of the Parliament band. His mom tried to keep him away from, you know, the R&B stuff. His mom wanted him to be a classical musician, which he is, and he mastered that. But he just chose to, you know, do R&B and funk music. And, you know, the dude, they got this movie called, what's the name of this movie? It was a documentary on him. If I remember it, next week I'll let you guys know. I'll remind you guys, maybe I'll pick it up or check it out. But they was interviewing, like, Mos Def, George Clinton, Bootsy Collins, a couple other people that knew of him, and they were saying that this dude, he was able to play like 6-7 keyboards at one time and not get in the way with neither one. Now, I know that don't make sense, but he was able to play like 6-7 keyboards at one time and not get in neither one of them's way. Everything just flowed, like the song Flashlight, all that keyboard, the bass parts and everything, that was all burning, you know what I'm saying? Just gifted to the T, man, and died from cancer, you know. So man, you know, check that out. That's a little history lesson. I always like to throw that out there. That kind of stuff tell you guys my age, that you know that I'm pretty old. But check that out. Burner Rail, he passed on last week, and you would do yourself some good to just do some history on it, brother. You'd be surprised of all the stuff that we think that is new to us. He invented some of them things. Like, he was the Moog man. You know what I'm saying? He make a mini Moog sound like a guitar, a bass, or whatever. You know what I'm saying? So, Barney Rurrell. And that's the producer news for today. In about a minute, I'm going to have S1 on the show. S1 and Vohnbeatz. You're listening to the Show Lab Producer Podcast. Yeah.
Are you looking for those heavy trap bangers? Then you definitely need to holler at Rock House Music, specialized and known for those bending 808s. You may have heard his recent work on K-Drama's The 8 album. So if that's the sound you're going for, holler at my man Anthony over at Rock House Music. You can check out his beats on SoundCloud at www.soundcloud.com/IamRockHouse. Again, that's www.soundcloud.com/IamRockHouse. Rock House Music, home of the bending 808s. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
You are listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast, the podcast that's strictly for producers.
Yes, sir. You're listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast, man. I am your boy, Mar for Mo Beats. I am excited about this show, man. This gentleman, if you're a producer, you have heard of this guy. S1, I got S1 and his son Vohnbeatz on the show. Before I bring him on, I just want to say the reason I wanted to do this interview was his son Vohnbeatz does beat. He's a producer too, and I just thought it was so important and unique on how his son has took on the role of being a producer, and S1 passing it down to his son. So I would like to welcome them guys to the show. What up, y'all?
What up?
How y'all doing today, man?
Man, doing great, man. Just trying to stay cool in this Texas weather.
Tell me about it, man. It can't get hot out. I mean, it sucks. I don't know about y'all, but down here, in the Austin area, man, we was getting rain for almost a month straight, but it looked like the heating sucked everything up.
Oh, man. It's easy to do that. It's that hot.
Yes, it is, man.
Yeah.
Well, man, before we get into the interview, man, I just want you guys to introduce yourselves tell the people what you do, who you are, and all that good stuff.
So, yeah, this is, I go by the name of S1, a.k.a. Symbolic One. I'm a music producer. And, man, I just love making music. I love inspiring people. I love encouraging people. I love motivating individuals, man. And that's probably me in a nutshell.
I go by the name of Vohnbeatz, you know, 18-year-old producer, been producing for about 9 years now. I'm really just all about having fun doing this, man, because, you know, it's all what I love.
Right.
I love, I'm a student, you know, getting ready to move to Cali.
You just graduated from high school, right?
Yeah, I just graduated.
Nope, no doubt, man. I've been knowing about you for a long time. Look, when we was at iStanders, you know, I've been with you for a minute because I put out one of them. I put out that strange fruit project on you.
Yeah,
with you, you and Caleb McCampbell. But how did you get into production, bro?
Pretty much with me, man. I guess I would say it was actually after high school. I consider myself a late bloomer in this music thing. I mean, during junior high and high school, like, I was in the band. I played alto sax.
Uh-huh.
But when I graduated high school, me and my cousin, Miss, who's in Strange Fruit Project,
right?
We linked together, and he was always like, he was diehard lyricist. He was always freaking out and writing rhymes. So he kind of like inspired me to do that. We hooked up with this cat that I graduated with, this DJ cat named Rob K.
Uh-huh.
And my cousin and I, we would go to his house every weekend, literally. And just record demos,
right?
You know, write songs, record demos. So that's when our group Symbolic Element, you know, was created. And I think months after doing that, it came to a point that we were really serious about it. I just wanted to know how beats were made. So
right.
I started to research different producers, and I started to research different equipment and how just research the art of production in itself.
Uh-huh.
And then I just was very curious on how that was made. So one thing led to another. My dad bought me this little Gemini sampler where I could sample like 8 seconds.
Right.
And then I just started to continue to grow in the production world, and just start to just learn, you know, learn as much as I can, and that translated into me producing for the group.
Wow, man. You know, and again, bro, just that whole Strange Fruit project. You can tell that it was. You can hear the passion in it, man. You know, to this day, you know, and let me tell you, don't get it twisted, bro. I just didn't play that joint because you was at the iStand, and that mug is in rotation on my phone, dog.
Man, that's crazy.
Yeah, man. And, you know, and me being a student of music and production, man, you know, you were one of those guys that I really admired. Just I admired the musicianship that you brought to the table, man.
I really appreciate that.
No doubt, man. No doubt, bro. Bob says, give honor where honor is due, man. So you definitely have put in the work, and one of those guys that I'm a student of, man. When you first started out, I know you had the group and stuff. You were putting out these beat tapes all the time. Why was it important to put out those beat tapes back in the day? And because I still got those too. I have those on my iMac. I just didn't have those on my laptop, but I got the beat tapes. When you give all your information, how to get in contact with your soul controllers at such and such, you dig? So,
yeah, man. Yeah, I think the beat tape era was that era where, okay, I had I had did the Strange Fruit thing, where I was still doing the Strange Fruit thing, and we was having a lot of success
right
with the group. But people only really knew me for the sound that I gave the group.
Right.
You know, which was very, like, melodic, soulful, you know, but I wanted to kind of showcase that, you know, this is not all that I do. Like, I can do other things.
Right.
Yeah, so that was, like, my reason for, like, the beat tapes, and in the process of doing the beat tapes, I was doing showcases. And at the showcase, I would have the beat tapes, so I would be promoting my beat tapes at the showcase. So, so that's kind of where that was derived from, just wanting to show and just wanting to present and display the other side of the production world that I was capable of.
Wow. I tell you what, man. I tell you what, dog, they were so refreshing when they came out, bro. Like, I think it might have been one and two. The fourth quarter joints.
Oh, fourth quarter, yeah.
Yeah, man. Yeah, dog. I hold those. Look, there's certain beat tapes that I have that I keep just on a specific hard drive, bro, so I can make sure the mugs don't, that my computer don't crash, and I can go back to them.
Man, I'm gonna need to get them for you. I haven't heard those in a minute.
Man, I can definitely email them to you, send them to you, bro, because I got them, bro. I got them, George.
Yeah,
right.
It's always good to go back to that stuff and just kind of see where I was at. Previously.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, back then.
Right, right. Man, when did you realize, okay, now you're a producer, and, you know, for those that really want to get an in-depth interview, go check out Ill Minds. They got the Blap Chat. Podcast that S1 was on about a month ago, where he gives detail of, you know, how he started. And you know, I was telling your wife and at the Beat Camp Dallas, it was so refreshing to hear, you know, you guys struggle and stuff, and just how, you know, you knew this is what you wanted to do, but you had to put yourself on a certain budget and stuff, man. So that was very encouraging, bro. That was encouraging like a mug.
Oh, I appreciate that, man.
No doubt. Man, when did you realize, now that you're producing all that and you got the Strange Fruit project coming going, and you got the beat tapes going, what made you realize Vohn wanted to get into production? And Vohn, I got some questions for you too. I'm just trying to get it from Pop's perspective real quick.
Well, with Vohn, it was a situation where when he was born, like I was producing when he was born. So, like when he was one and 2 years old, he was in the studio with me.
And, wow.
You know, yeah. So I think it was just a thing with him where he just kind of picked it up, and you know, just him being around it.
Uh huh.
You know, so as he continued to grow older, like, I guess he realized at some point that it was just something that he was interested in and he wanted to try. So I think around 8 or 9 years old is when I first set him up with reason on his computer. And,
right.
and I just let him go with it and just figure it out.
Right.
You know, I think it was just a matter of him being around it all the time. So it was a natural progression.
Right, right. And, you know, and that's a good segue into my next question, was it something that you pushed him to do, or did you just let him grow into for himself?
Yeah, absolutely not. Like I kind of disagree with pushing kids into certain things.
Yes, yes.
So
yes.
It was actually a situation where he asked me, he was always asking to make beats, or, you know, so it was definitely something that he wanted to do, and he was interested in and curious about. So,
right.
You know, I just kind of gave it to him, kind of let him feel his way out, and I would show him a few things here and there.
Right.
But the main thing is just kind of let him develop his own
right.
thing.
Right.
And you know, he would ask certain questions if he wanted to know, I would tell him, but just kind of let him grow into his own on individuals.
Yeah.
Creative individuals.
Yeah, you know, I'm a firm believer in that too, man. You know, my one of my twins, he's a drummer. He's a drummer as well as I'm a drummer as well. And one thing I definitely and I should tell my wife this all the time, I would say, baby, you know, I'm not going to push him to do it. It got to come from an authentic and an organic place.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? Creating his own path, creating his own lane. Now, I'm there to coach if he got any questions or if he gets stuck. You know what I'm saying? Of course, I'm going to be there. But as a musician, I always felt that it was important to figure whatever you're doing out on your own, because then nobody would be able to tell you how to use it, because you have learned how to perfect, you know, this particular instrument or whatever it may be. You know what I'm saying? So I'm definitely a firm believer in, you know, just allowing them to have the room to grow on their own. At the same time, you know, being that coach when they need me. Vohn, this is for you, bro. Once you being in the studio with Pops, you know what I'm saying, and now you starting to get this producer itch. Was there ever a time you felt intimidated or nervous when you first told your dad you wanted to produce?
Nah, because you know, being so young, you don't really think about know, like, what you really getting into. You know, I just knew I wanted to, you know, be a part of music, do something that involved music, because, you know, I've been around it pretty much my whole life, and that's like, it just comes so easy to me, and it's so natural.
Right.
You know, I'm just in love with it.
Right, right. Wow. I tell you what, man, what a better dad to have than an industry vet. You know what I'm saying? I mean, you know,
right.
You know, as I was sitting down, putting the questions together, you know, I guess that was the first thing, you know, came to my mind, but not realizing you were that young neither. And you're right. When you're that young, you're not really feeling nervous or anything, versus you being a teenager and then you come and say, hey dad, I think I want to produce too. So I guess starting out so young, it made it a little easier to do. How long did it take you to learn how to use Reasons, bro?
It didn't really take long at all.
Mm-hmm.
Cause what my pops really did, mm-hmm, was just gave me like the foundation, but I had to build the house on my own. You know?
Wow.
So it was like, I was a really curious kid. How would I do this? You know, so I promised I would search everything. I looked up so many tutorials. Do well, you're not really gonna do well if you're not putting in the work to get there. You know.
Real quick, S1, bro. Once you seen that Vohn was serious about it, when did you in your mind say, okay, you know what, he might be ready for our standard beat battle, or he may be able, he's ready to start working with artists? I mean, was there a time when you said, okay, he's ready? And the reason I'm asking that, bro, because me as a dad, bro, you know what I'm saying, I want to make sure, you know, that the timing is right, even with my kids.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You know, you don't want to put them out there too. You wouldn't want to put them out there too quick, and then too soon. You know what I'm saying?
And that's pretty much the thing. Like, I think early on, so like from 8,
yeah,
or 8, 9 up to. When did you
play
guitar here?
How old were you?
11.
Wow.
So I guess from about 8 to 11, like, that was like straight training. And him just making, you know, because with anything to get better at it, it's just repetition.
Right.
You know, it's just doing it over and over and over till it's second nature. So that was just training and just showing him and him learning certain things.
Uh-huh.
And then the music that he was doing was progressing so fast.
Right.
His age. So I don't know. I don't think it was like one a particular time or a particular joint that I heard that I would be like, he's ready. I think it was just a natural progression into, okay, let's just send, I think these are good records. Let me just send these over to an artist or put these in the batch with mine, you know, and see what they think. And, you know, and around that time when he was 11, I did that and sent some to Talib, and Talib wound up using like two or three of his joints.
Wow, that is crazy. Yeah. That is crazy. Hey, Vohn, look, let me ask you something. How was them how was that royalty check at 11 years old?
At 11, I ain't really cheap.
But you said Pops was the manager, so he worked all that out, huh?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was basically for a mixtape.
Oh, okay. All right.
Anyway, so, you know.
Right, right. But hey,
it was,
man.
But it's still good for him, you know. Just
yes. Yes. Definitely.
That just led to working with other people, of course.
Right, right. Vohn, do you remember your first iStandard showcase, bro? And what was the preparation for it?
Man, my first iStandard showcase. Actually, there's a video on YouTube of it. I think it was 2009.
Uh-huh.
Man, it was, man, because, like, it was just, like, all my idols in one room. We had Nice Wonders.
Wow.
Just Blaze was there.
Wow.
So many people, man, at the one-stop shop in Phoenix.
Yeah.
And it was like, man, to see everybody vibing out while I'm on the stage.
Right.
It was just like that confidence, man. It was like, man, like, I could actually go somewhere producing, you know?
Right.
It was like, yeah, and being young with it too, having people come up to me afterwards, it was a great feeling.
Right, right, right. Well, S1, let me ask you this, bro. How important is it for you to keep Vohn balanced, yet being a young person? And, man, you know, all those accolades and stuff, man, that definitely can go to your head. And, you know, before you know it, pride to be on an all-time high. You know, how important is it, or how much are you really, you know, being mindful of how he's carrying himself in the industry?
Man, I think it's very important. Like I tell a lot of producers, like your integrity and the way you carry yourself, like that's bigger than almost the talent nowadays. Because I know me personally, I've been worked in so many situations or been given a lot of opportunities based off just that.
Right.
You know, just not being a butthole or with, you know,
right,
you know, and just, and, you know, and just being a good person and doing what you're supposed to do,
right?
So I always preach that. And then just with the balance, I think with my situation, like it worked out for me. It's definitely a blessing because my wife is very involved in what I do.
And yes,
he's a producer, so he's involved in what I do. So
right,
so that's the balance. So even when I'm working, like, we're still working together, you know.
Yeah.
So it makes it a little, it makes the dynamics a little different.
Right, right,
you know,
right.
But still, you know, we still have, you know, family time, and I'm still able to give myself work hours.
Right.
And outside of those work hours, we still can, we'll go to the movies or play pool or go shoot basketball in the back. And, you know, so I really feel like that's having that balance is so important because a lot of people get lost into work.
Yeah. And, man, you know, and that is a real struggle for us, a struggle for us as producers.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, man, I tell you what. Yeah, man, you know, I'm starting to realize that now, man, you know, Lord's willing, I'll be 40 next year. And let me say this, bro. I know that I did an interview last week with a guy, man, and we were just talking about seasons and stuff, man. And, you know, I'm one of those ones, man, to when it's time for me to move in a season, you know, I'm a gracefully move, you know what I'm saying? And, you know, and now, man, my oldest is 20. Then I got 15-year-old twins in the house, man, and I got an 11-year-old and 8-year-old son. And man, I have been really been having this burden and this conviction about, hey, man, spending more time with these boys. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's so important, man.
Yeah. You know, I find myself, man, if I'm, especially if I'm working on projects, I may be working on multiple projects, man. Sometimes I literally stay in my studio, man. I wake up in the studio, fall asleep in the studio. You know what I'm saying? So
trust me, I know about that.
you know what I'm saying? So I definitely can relate and taking heed to making sure you're spending that balanced time. You know, with the family and stuff. What would you tell a producer, you know what I'm saying, that got kids and stuff, that may be into the music? Believe it or not, bro, you're being an influence, because I see Fred Bruno, he's doing that with his son now. You know what I'm saying? They like, you know, so shouts out to Fred and Brown Royal. He won the if I'm not mistaken, his son won the showcase for the Beat Camp Dallas joint.
Yep, it sure did.
You know what I'm saying? So, you know, with that being said, man, you are, you know, people are realizing and paying attention to, you know, just the dynamic that you and your son have, man. What advice would you give, you know, to a parent, you know what I'm saying, that got kids and, you know, paying attention to what their kids are doing and making sure that they're putting that quality time and, you know, investing into the kids?
Man, I would just say that... first of all, you know, let them grow into what they're supposed to be. Like, don't force them into anything, because then, you know, it's not authentic and it's not organic. You got to let it be authentic and organic as to what their purpose that they're supposed to serve and the direction that they're supposed to go in life. Second, I would say just know how to balance, because, you know, like you were just speaking of. It's hard sometimes. Like, I have to constantly remind myself every day. And I think one of the key things that you have to do is time management. Like, time management is so important, and I'm very I gotta really like stay on top of that, because you know what you have to do is, and basically what you have to do is dedicate time for each thing. So this time is dedicated for music projects or whatever, and this time is dedicated to family time or spending time with my sons or daughters or whatever it is.
Right.
You know, you have to put that in place.
Right.
And then from there, you just gotta be obedient, and you gotta be disciplined to do that.
Right. Man, that is always the constant battle for producers, bro.
Absolutely.
Yes, that's a constant battle. Vohn, man, what you gonna be majoring in school, bro?
I'm going strictly for music. I'll be attending Los Angeles College of Music, and I plan to major in music producing and recording. You know, just to better my knowledge and further my knowledge in, you know, in the game and, you know, really get technical stuff.
Right. Well, that's what's up, man. Any last words? Anything y'all got going on that you can share with us, man, that's coming in the future? I know sometimes you have to keep some under the hats, but is there anything we can be looking for and expecting from you guys?
I mean, of course, more dividends music for my pops, Sarah. I'm currently working on the EP just to showcase a little bit more of my talent, you know, because God has also blessed me with, you know, the ability to, you know, be an MC, but I don't really want that forefront, so, you know, I'm really just doing this to showcase what I can do.
Right.
But yeah, man, EP coming soon, and that's pretty much it, man.
That's what's up, man. Well, bro, I appreciate you guys coming on the show, man. I tell you what, you S1, bro, you're doing a beautiful thing with your son, bro. And I appreciate you guys coming on the show, bro, for real.
Oh, man, it's our pleasure, man. We appreciate you having us on.
Likewise, man. And, man, y'all keep doing your thing. Man, he just keep making good music. And, you know, I want to say this before we get out of here, man. You know, I know that you guys are, you know, believers. And, man, I just continue being a light. Continue being a light, bro. You know what I'm saying? I think. You know, I know we've briefly talked about it at our standard, man. But it's, you know, it's so hard on the outside looking in to see, you know, what the work is being done. So, you know, what I'm learning to do, man. I'm praying for the guys that are, you know, engaged and are connected into the industry, that, you know, that they look at it as a mission field as well as it being a means of taking care of the family. You know, so I'm definitely praying for y'all, bro.
Man, I sure appreciate it. That means a lot, man.
Yeah. So, man, y'all go ahead and get back to work, man. Do what you got to do. It sound like the FedEx man and the Federal Express man and the UPS all came in one time, you dig? But, man, again, bro, I appreciate y'all coming on the show, bro.
All right, man. Appreciate it, man. You have a good day, man.
You too, man. And you've been listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast, where we talk about nothing but producer stuff, you dig?
You're listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast, where we talk about nothing but producer stuff. You dig?
Are you working on a project and you're looking for your next banger? Well, check out the team over at SoundHBeats.com. Looking for a variety of production? Well, the homie Ray and the crew over there can take care of all of your musical needs. They got exclusives, leases, and they got a clearance sale over there. Are your artists on a budget? Well, now they are offering bulk discount prices on their lease beats. So what you waiting on? Head on over to SoundHBeatz.com and pick up your banger today. Christian music, all hard. SoundHBeatz.com. Are you a producer or artist that is lacking confidence in your music? Well, now you can get your music critiqued by an industry vet. The Amazing Beat Critique by Producer Vet, The Amazing SB. Get your one-on-one video consultation via Skype or FaceTime. Submit 3 beats or 3 songs, and he will provide feedback and any questions that you may have pertaining to your music or the industry. So contact The Amazing SB today at AmazingBeatCritique@gmail.com. Again, that's AmazingBeatCritique@gmail.com. Contact them and book your session today.
You are listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast, the podcast that's strictly for producers.
Are you looking for those heavy trap bangers? Then you definitely need to holler at Rock House Music, specialized and known for those bending 808s. You may have heard his recent work on K-Drama's The 8 album. So if that's the sound you're going for, holler my man Anthony over at Rock House Music. You can check out his beats on SoundCloud at www.soundcloud.com/IamRockHouse. Again, that's www.soundcloud.com/IamRockHouse. Rock House Music, home of the bending 808s. Yes, sir. This show has been brought to you by sacredapparel.net. The homie Twink and the crew over there are always coming up with the latest fashions, the tees, the hoodies, and the hats. Right now, they got a store-wide sale going on, everything 20% off. This would be a great time to pick up a hoodie. Everything 40% off, regular price $40, now they $25 a hoodie. And the dope thing that I like about Sacred Apparel, they got tees for the big homies. So go check them out, sacredapparel.net, a clothing store for the ladies and gentlemen that choose to live sacred. You dig?
Hey, yo, what's poppin'? It's your boy Swift, a.k.a. Chef Boyard Swift, a.k.a. Dr. Swigglesworth. You are now listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast with my man Marv from Old Beats, you know what I'm saying? If you listening to any other podcast, you're slacking. Producers, step your game up by learning from the best. You dig? Holla at your boy. Peace.
Yes, sir. You're listening to the ShowLab Producer Podcast. I am your boy, Marv from Old Beatz. Man, I hope y'all enjoyed that interview. S1 and Vohnbeatz, thank you guys for stopping in, hollering at your boy. Again, man, just talking about the importance of, you know, helping captivate and expound your kids' gifts, you know what I'm saying? Helping them to walk in their destiny. It's so important that we do that as parents. It's a responsibility to be able to help them be successful. Sometimes, you know, sometimes us as parents, man, we have to find that balance, because sometimes you'll be trying to, you know, your dreams and stuff, you'll be trying to fulfill your dreams through them versus finding out what their gifts and their talents are and helping captivate the gifts that are in them. So, yeah, man, definitely good information there on how to and, you know, what to look for and all that stuff, man. So if you're a parent and you got kids, definitely something that you want to pass on. I got this article that I wanted to read a couple of weeks ago, and it was in my notes, and I forgot to read it. Yeah, I don't think I read it. But, and it's, and you may say it sounds very cliche-ish, but it's a topic, something that is always in the air, and it's talking about what is the difference between a beat maker and a producer. And I found this article over at indiehiphop.net, Music 101, what is a beat maker versus producer. And the young lady, it was a good write-up, very short but to the point. She said, what is a beat maker? Usually this is a person who sells or leases the beat to an artist before ideas, lyrics, arrangements, etc. Right? Hold on, popped off. Let me go back to it. This person has no influence on how the record turns out or the direction of the project. Once you get the beat, exclusivity, not a lease, you're pretty much done with the person until the album is released. Industry terminology of a lease beat means that the beat maker is free to let other artists lease the beat until exclusivity is bought. I don't know why she just ain't said exclusive, but until the exclusive is purchased. As soon as the exclusive is bought, make sure you have your paperwork straight. The lease beat is then that of the purchaser. I don't do lease beats. I only do exclusive. So I ain't into that. Now then she has, what is a producer? A producer is a person, is the person who decides the direction of the project. They take the beat and help it to evolve into a song. They are there in the studio and have an active voice in the arrangements, pitches, or tone. They are then given producer rights for their input and hard work. Sometimes a beat maker is involved into the production of the song, depending on the level of the involvement. This starts to get a little tricky depending on the situation. For example, producers like Jazzy Faye, Jermaine Dupri, Timbaland have beat makers signed to them. This allows them to have variations of different sounds to fit different artists. But because they have these beat makers signed to them, they are able to take the headline credit for the work, even though they are involved with the direction. So in other words, they have ghost producers, which is a norm in the industry. Although the beat maker receives payment, they often don't receive the credit at the end of the day. So the question is, what are you? Are you a beat maker, or are you a producer, or are you both? Sometimes I'm a beat maker, and then sometimes I'm a producer. Now, me and T. Wilder, we talked about this on his podcast, just talking about, you know, just the whole vibe of being in the studio with people. We know that, you know, a lot of transactions are done over the email and through Skype and through Google Chat and all that stuff. Does that not make you a producer if you're just emailing and all that? What I think... I think, and what and sometimes in you know, in the positions that I play, I do like to get involved with the producers, I mean with the artists, talk to them, see what kind of ideas they're looking for, you know, email them back and forth. There have been on occasions where I have per se executive produced, you know, projects, you know what I'm saying, produce the beats and come up with different concepts and ideas. But then I consider myself as just a beat maker too. You know what I'm saying? I sell beats to take care of my family. I don't want to say beat maker is the least of a musician. It just depends on the position that you're in. You know, some producers are just beat makers. You know what I'm saying? But then they have individuals that are producers, and then they have individuals that are both. All I would say to it is, whatever you are, just do it to the best of your capability, you know what I'm saying, and do it good. Make good music, whether it's just selling beats online or being a producer. I've been holding off wanting to do a podcast about leased beats because it just seemed like it's, to me personally, it's like beating a dead horse. Most of you guys that know me and listen to the podcast, y'all know I'm anti-lease beats. But it worked for some people. It's just not my cup of tea, man. It seems like there's more trouble in the latter when you think about it, you know. But I thought it was a good article. I think I may go ahead and post this up on the website, you know. And, you know, you make your assessment on the interview. Next week, Lord's willing, I'm hoping and praying, if my wife is not too busy, to have her on the show. My beautiful queen, Damaris, will be on the show next week. Hopefully, if I can get her to come in here and re-record the interview. We're going to be talking about the life of a producer's spouse. You know, the person, my wife, you know what I'm saying? She is the backbone of what I do, you know. I've said it, y'all have heard me say it many times, you know. A lot of things wouldn't be popping if my wife wouldn't encourage me. You know, I'm even thinking about this podcast. I think my wife even mentioned to me maybe 2 years ago about, you know, doing some kind of podcast. But you know what happened? I think I just brushed it off to the side. Didn't go back to it, but truth be told, this was an idea that she planted, and she planted that seed. And I think maybe 2 years later, you know, here we are, the Show Lab Producer Podcast. So I'm having my wife on the show, man, just talking about, you know what I'm saying, the sacrifices that she have to make, you know what I'm saying, you know, it's a lot, you know what I'm saying, just on an everyday, you know, basis, you know what I'm saying? Like, this is time consuming, you know, taking time away from being in the family, and how, you know, she kind of just, you know, I want to say take the slack or whatever. But anyway, I'm gonna have her on the show, just talk about, you know, just the role that she plays. They play an important role, man. Sometimes, man, my wife, I be feeling like my wife is my only fan, you know what I'm saying? A lot of things that, you know, that I have had doubts about it. You know, my wife be like, baby, come on, stop being a chump. Let's do it. You can do it. You know what I'm saying? So I want to have her on the show, man, because, you know, man, I mean, they have a lot of, you know, women and men that husbands or wives or producers, you know what I'm saying? And they play an intricate part in, you know, that musician or producer's life, you know what I'm saying? So we just want to have on the show. I ain't going to edit anything, so it was going to be the real. It's going to be the good and the bad. I don't know how it's going to turn out, but, you know, I'm going to have on the show. I think it would be a very interesting interview to be able to hear from that perspective. All right? I normally would have a producer thought, man, but I just got sidetracked with the 4th of July, and I apologize, but I will be back with a producer thought on next week, Lord's willing. I did the podcast in the hour. It is 4:59, and I am about to get out of here, man. I love you guys. Tell your mom and them. Tell everybody, please, 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 please. Let me cut the music off and say please about 10 times. Please, 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 please. Spread the word about the podcast, man. If you are enjoying the podcast, please send out a tweet, repost it, share it, leave a comment on iTunes or on Spreaker. Let us know how we doing. You know, I when I look at the statistics, it say we doing good. You know, people are listening, but I would love to hear from you guys. What's your thoughts? How you feel? If you like the podcast or if the podcast suck, I am good with constructive. I'm good in taking constructive criticism. Might hurt my feelings, but I'm good with it. I need it. You know, that helps me be better. So please spread the word. Let everyone know, man, about the Show Lab Producer Podcast. I want to be the plug for producers. I want to be the supplier for the knowledge and the information. There are plenty other podcasters out there. Shout out to Blab Chad, you know, Illmind's, what these do. You got the Beat People. Dope podcasts and video podcasts. But I want to be a supplier of good knowledge for producers, you know. Discussing different topics, different things. So please, man, let us know if there's something you want us to talk about, if there's someone you want to try to interview. Please let us know, and I will try to do that. So until next time, I love you guys. Lord's willing, I see y'all next Tuesday. And until then, peace.
You're listening to the Show Lab Producer Podcast, where we talk about nothing but producer stuff. You dig?